see reason. Thank you to many of you for coming again a second time. This is definitely mean that you think the space we're creating is valuable. But most importantly, thank you for, on such a warm day, not going off for a picnic or going having ice cream. And we tried, we don't have air conditioning. Tadashi from Japan is shocked, but there we are. Well being without air conditioning, but we have slight window opening. However, we have, most importantly, Professor Gertler here, who is agreed with us, it's cooler in here than outside. So in terms of your well-being, you're better off here than outside. And Professor Gertler is going to kick off, and he is an amazing person. I've had the pleasure of the last 2 days, with Flavio's help, of digging out nuggets of fascinating things about Professor Gertler. And we all know he's a leading player in the field of social choice. But what you may not know is that he's been involved in peace talks, in bringing people together for a long period. He's involved in social activities, and maybe in the coffee break afterwards we can ask him more about these speeches. And particularly when one trawls the net for exciting things, you find comments of other people, and people have written about Professor Gertler saying that he makes things accessible, what every economist should learn. I was thinking of our colleague here, Dr. Chang, 23 things about capitalism. Every economist agrees that preferences are not constant over time, and experience and learning and habit formation and social environment are important factors of influence. And those of us working, of course, in the capability field think very much and often about these features, and often this is the reason that we are sitting in this space and trying to puzzle over what it is that preferences do for human beings. And therefore, for him to come inaugurate our second conference, to be able to talk to us about things that when I studied economics, the Arrow's impossibility theorem seemed dated, but actually they've all come back full circle. Arrow is probably more relevant today than he was even in the 1970s. And thinking through either the technical conditions of what it means to have necessary and sufficient conditions for well-being is probably particularly pertinent today as we stand at the point where we talk about austerity and difficulty. And so it gives me great pleasure to invite Professor Gertler to give our first talk. Thank you very much. Please.
Well, thank you very much for this wonderful introduction. I was wondering whether you were really talking about me or somebody else. And I must say that I'm very grateful to be here, but also I have my doubts, because when I got my first letter from Professor Comin, Flavio, I said, I'm not qualified for this, because my work on capabilities dates back to the mid 2005 area, sort of, and since then I've veered away to other areas. At the moment I'm doing experimental work in game theory, and so it's quite far away from this earlier work, and so I said no. And then it was also personally a very difficult time for me at that time, because my brother just had died, and I thought, you know, there are so much more important things. I'm giving a talk here in Cambridge in June. But it was really the warmth of your letter which convinced me at the end to say yes. And now I'm here. So thank you very much for all this. I really appreciate this. Okay, so as you can see, the many facets of social choice theory. What I want to do is not to give you a survey or an overview of all these areas which now belong these days to social choice theory, but just pick, let's say, three or four of these areas. And as you will see in a moment, I'm not very good in presenting PowerPoint things, because normally what I do is that I work on blackboards, and then I need much larger blackboards than these ones. And I was lecturing at the University of Munich several times for philosophers, and also they only had PowerPoint devices, and I wanted a board, and then the caretaker came with a very small wooden board in black, where I had about half the size of this, and I had to lecture on this. This was really hard. So this is really an improvement. Don't worry, I will only present you one example, which is in some sense at my heart, and you will see later on why it is, where I will use this. So most of the time we look at this, and as you can see, we talk about some aggregation functions, then an analogy of rights exercising, where I did a little bit of work, and freedom. The procedural aspect, this is an aspect really which I chose because I think not much has been done in this area. And then your area, capability sets. And I'm a bit, you know, scary about this because, as I said, my work dates back at least 10 years ago, and you have probably done very important new developments in this area, which I haven't. Okay, so some of the areas in social choice theory, but not all of them, are, and this has already been mentioned, existence of welfare functions under various domains, the issue of manipulability, scoring rules of different kinds, then the expansion of the informational basis, which is basically due to a person who very often resides in Cambridge, UK, but also in Cambridge, Mass, Amartya Sen. He has done important work in this area of really expanding and going beyond simple utility functions and taking into consideration all kinds of other non-welfaristic aspects. So I think this is really an important development which was started in the 70s and then, you know, also taken up by other persons in the 80s. So this is really a real achievement, I think, in social choice theory. So it also then reached equity evaluations, dealing with Rawls and dealing with Harshani and some newer developments in this area. Then, of course, analysis of capability sets, topological methods, which is a bit out-fashioned at the moment. Graciela Czerniski did some work on this. This was in fashion, let's say, in 80, 85. Individual rights, personal freedom. I could add some more. For example, recently there has been a lot of work on networks. I have done a little bit and written a book which was published in a company which is here in Cambridge on empirical social choice, where we take social choice axioms and check whether students intuitively, that's very important, intuitively follow these axioms, these requirements, ethical requirements, like the equity axiom, which underlies the Rawls and principle, for example. So this is another of these areas which I perhaps should mention. Now, I think, and this is something I'm, again, this year teaching at Humboldt University in Berlin, I was just telling my students when they're, you know, at Humboldt University, they are complaining a lot about modern economic theory, that it is too far away from reality. And they learn a lot of, you know, theorems and results in this area of, you know, all kinds of areas, of course, macro and micro. And I said to them, I think that social choice theory is, at least at the moment, very up to date, because, for example, you know, the Brexit outcome is due to the fact that Mr. Cameron never really thought about saying that if we take such a severe and profound decision, perhaps we should have some qualified rule, which means perhaps two-thirds, and not just simple majority, in order to decide whether to leave the European Union or not. So this is one of the examples where perhaps another measure would have prevented what is now happening in this country, you know, a hard Brexit or a soft Brexit or whatever will happen in the next 2 years maybe. As you know, they are just starting negotiating today. Then for Germany, for example, it was very interesting, you know, when the wall had fallen down. Eventually, there was a possibility to have Berlin as the capital of Germany, but of course, there were interests in the Rhineland to keep Bonn as the capital. So there was a public voting on this in Parliament. And what they decided was a two-stage rule, which eventually brought the decision to really send everything, you know, or almost everything, all ministries and of course chancery and everything else to Berlin. But had they used, for example, as one of my colleagues found out from the preferences of the delegates in parliament, had they used the border method, Bonn would have remained capital. Another interesting thing is, and one of my students at Humboldt has just written a very nice paper on this, Maria Salas, the American elections of 2016, where they have this particular system of electoral college, which is a winner-take-all principle. And if they had allocated, and you know, of course, the results, that Trump won by about 70 or even more than 70 votes more than Clinton in the Electoral College. Though Clinton, Hillary Clinton, had 2.8 or 2.9 million more votes than he had. Had one assigned the seats in the Electoral College in a proportional way, there would have been a close neck-to-neck outcome, or even, because then there's a rounding problem, because, you know, persons fortunately are integer valued, so you have to round. And so it could have been that she would have had a slight majority. At least there would have been something like very close to each other. But due to the Electoral College, he won enormously, though again, 2.8 or 9 million people voted, or, you know, there was this majority for Hillary. So you see, these things are very close to what we experience these days. So I think that social choice theory is not totally outdated in what it does in its research. Now, concerning aggregation functions, of course there's this impossibility result. The impossibility result hinges tremendously on the axioms which Arrow claimed should be demanded, should be required. And what I want to do here is that I want to talk very briefly about one of these essential assumptions which you made, the independence axiom. Then I want to talk about Condorcet consistency and the property of never to choose a Condorcet loser and the no-show paradox. Now, the independence condition is such, I don't want to use the word now, that you have two profiles, and let's say we look at the decision between X and Y. Now, if the decisions, ordinarily speaking, because the arrow setup is in ordinal utility terms, if between X and Y, the relationships among all the persons who vote, all the persons who express their preferences, if the relationship between X and Y in this profile is exactly the same as the relationship in this profile, then the outcome here, whatever it is, should be the same as the outcome there, not depending on any other alternatives, but just on X and Y. So this is a very important condition, which, for example, the border rule violates, and some other rules violate. And then you can discuss whether this was a position of error. It is really a condition which makes a lot of sense in this kind of problem, or whether you would perhaps like to modify it and at least weaken it or abolish it altogether. Another one is the Condorcet consistency condition, which is such that Marquis de Condorcet, who was one of these important writers around the French Revolution, together with Border actually, and they were fighting, you know, they each had their own idea, the border rule versus the Condorcet or majority rule. If there is a majority winner, it will be called a Condorcet winner. Now, for some profiles, we of course do not get a Condorcet winner because we will get preference cycles, and this was already known to Condorcet. Now, unfortunately, I don't know, the border principle can violate Condorcet consistency. So there is this problem, you know, of ranking rules and majority type rules. Majority type rules can run into problems by creating cycles, which the border rule never does. So you might say, oh, that's wonderful for the border rule. And Donsari, a real proponent of the would say, you see, we don't have problems with cycles. On the other hand, if you really believe that if there is an alternative which majority-wise is at least as good or even better than any other alternative, and you think that it should then be picked, and the border rule does not, I have a little example for this, then you might say, well, now it's getting difficult. I really don't know how to judge these situations. Now, something which is clearer is you don't want a Condorcet loser. A Condorcet loser is an alternative which majority-wise is beaten by every other alternative. But there are rules, actually, which violate this principle, and I have one rule which I will show you in a moment. The other thing is the no-show paradox. The no-show paradox is really a tricky thing. Because normally, I would say, and the border rule and, for example, the Condorcet principle, they all are in harmony with this kind of principle. Normally, it is such that if, for example, you know, there is a voting and the outcome is in favor of X, let's say, and now you go from one profile to another profile, and at least one person changes the preference for, let's say, from Y over X to Y indifferent to X, or from Y indifferent to X to X strictly preferred to Y, this should not harm X. This should not harm X. So if there is a movement or a little push towards X, this should never harm this particular alternative. Now you can show that Condorcet-type rules have the following, unfortunately, the following property or satisfy the following property, that it may be advantageous for some people not to vote for X anymore. And this will help, and you will see that in an example which I will present in a moment. So these are the things which I would like to discuss very briefly. I have to watch, you know, because I would like to do more than just this kind of thing and go through other things as well. So, for example, the now you see that I'm not well coordinated. This example here. This example here shows you that we have seven voters and we have four alternatives. And now, why is the Condorcet when I was four against three against all other alternatives? And you might say, oh, well, wonderful, Condorcet winners, so why should be selected? Yes, of course. But X is a border winner with 15 points against 12 for Y. 12 for Y. So X wins against Z and V with 6 to 1. Of course, loses against Y. Y is the Condorcet winner. So which one would you then pick, Y or X? As I say to my students, I have no answer for this because I don't have a meta-theory. And I don't think there is a meta-theory for this kind of analysis. So you have to make up your own mind and, again, look into yourself and find out how important for you is, for example, the property of being a Condorcet winner. And there are two schools, actually, there are several schools, but at least two main schools in social choice theory. The Condorcet fans and the border fans. And, you know, in some sense it's a bit ideological. They don't really meet in the sense of, you know, finding a compromise. What would be a compromise? I don't know, really. But there are these schools and they exchange their arguments and that's it. Now, there is another rule which was proposed by Walensky and Larraki a couple of years ago. They think that the rule should be quite different from the error rule. It should be ordinal, but it should be on a scale. For example, on a scale from, let's say, excellent to fail. And then you have qualitative properties like excellent, very good, good, sufficient, almost sufficient, and so on, up to fail. And people should agree, people who vote, should agree on this common scale. And Walensky and Larraki, they always refer to something like figure skating competitions, wine tasting, or some others. And unfortunately, this rule, as you will see from this example here, has some drawbacks. And I have to apologize for these two persons from Paris because they really think that their rule is the best ever. When you look at these seven voters here, you will see that the grades go from A to H. H is highest, A is lowest. You will see that Z is a majority winner by 6-1 votes. X is a Condorcet loser because it loses 6-1 against Z, for example, but also against Y. But it has the highest median grade because this is the criterion which they choose. They say if you have now this this line of grades available, let's look for the median grade of each of the alternatives and then pick the one which is highest. So the one which is highest is E, and so X would be selected, though X is a Condorcet loser. Again, I have to apologize for those two because very often they argue these examples are totally artificial. Okay, if they are, forget about the example. Good. So I think I just skip another thing, which is an idea by Dodgson, Lewis Carroll. Lewis Carroll had the idea, which comes back or goes back to Condorcet, that if you have a cycle and you have these binary relationships among all elements in the cycle, look at the weakest majority, and in order to prevent the cycle or to abolish the cycle, look for the weakest part where, let's say, there's only a 2-1 majority, whereas for other other pairs there's something like 3-1 or 4-1 or even more, and then make a little switch and you are out of the cycle problem. And unfortunately, the Dodgson method, which is quite ingenious and follows Condorcet, to almost 200 years later, it violates the no-show paradox. I just leave this example out due to time, and just wanted to mention this. And I think this is very bad. You know that, as I said before, this idea that if you get support for an alternative, and it should not harm the alternative, or by just leaving out your support, you actually promote that alternative, is a very strange phenomenon, but it happens with quite a few rules. And this again is something which brought me to the title of a paper which I wrote recently, which I called Wickedness and Social Choice. And some of my colleagues said, how can you ever use the word wicked in connection with Arrow? I just wrote an obituary on Arrow with very deep and profound esteem, and I think this comment is a bit surprising, so it has nothing to do with wicked or something, but it's intricate. It's an intricate problem. And as I said, I don't have a meta theory for this. And I doubt whether others do have this. Now, this was my first part. The second part is now on rights, exercising, and freedom. And there was a recent paper by Professor Pasternak and Professor Shu from the United States on freedom, which is going to be published in an honorary volume for Kaushik Basu, where they say something about functions and freedom. And I thought that there is an immediate, let's say, similarity or analogy to the rights issue. Now, again, so you see my inability to do it properly here. Amartya Sen was the one who formulated an impossibility result, saying that if people exercise or have the possibility to exercise individual rights, and you have an unrestricted domain of preferences and you have weak Pareto, you get an impossibility result. Now, the same idea of exercising rights is the following. Let's assume that a particular person prefers social alternative X over social alternative Y, so we look at person I. And furthermore, we assume that X and Y belong to the sphere, to the right sphere
of that person. If this is the case, then either socially X should be preferred to Y, so that society takes up this preference and makes it into the social preference, or Y should be eliminated from further social choice. So it should not be an element of this. So what Sen does is the following, that individuals have preferences, there's a rights assignment structure, personal alternatives, of course, not war or not war or death sentence or no death sentence, you know, very personal alternatives. Let's say X and Y, but they are social alternatives, and when you look at Arrow's book from 1951, you will see that these are very complex structures, what an alternative actually means. So if they belong to the sphere of rights of person I, then, as I said, socially it should be either X preferred to Y, or that Y should be eliminated. Now, following, and this is a slide which you have already seen for a second or millisecond as cognitive scientists, not normally as milliseconds, Nozick, Gerben, Forst, Sugden, and others, and then Patanaik, Susumura, and myself, we thought that this is unintuitive. And now I'm very grateful for this whiteboard here, because let's assume, and this is my standard example, which you also find in my book, that you have two ladies who meet on Saturday evening at the tube station to go to a party. And they both own a white dress and a black dress. And one of those ladies is very much attaching importance to congruence in colors. So she is a conformist, and the other one wants that the colors are different. So the preferences, for example, of this one lady I'm focusing on are the following, that she prefers WW over BW and BB over W. Now, according to Sen and also Alan Gibbard, who did a lot of work in this area of rights exercising, very important work, not only on manipulability, it's really a very important work by this philosopher in the economics area. They would both claim, Sen and Gilbert would claim, you know, this pair here is such that the only change is with person, this person I'm considering. So this person is person one, and then there's person two, of course, and this always, the first letter always refers to person one. So they would argue that this is the this is part of the sphere of this particular person, because the only change is in her own sphere. And the same holds here. Now, Sen and Gibbard would say, okay, if this is the case, then according to our theory, this alternative should go and this alternative should go. They should be deleted in this sense. Now, we argue in terms of that individuals don't have the possibility to eliminate, except for particular circumstances, very special circumstances, they don't have the possibility to eliminate complete social states. The only thing which they can do is they can choose actions or strategies. Now, if we do it this way, then we would have person one, person two. I have to finish very shortly because you know this one is running out. So we have strategy WB, WB, right? So if we now look at the constellations, we would have WW, WB, BW, and BB. I hope you can see even from the back, this is fainting red stick here. Now, according, as I said, according to Gibbard and Sen, this would have to go and this would have to go because of this idea of eliminating complete social states. Now, imagine these two ladies going to the tube station and choosing their color, you know, not in a cooperative framework that they arrange things before they meet, but non-cooperatively. They just go there, and this is our conformist. Now, what she can do is she can choose W, and then all these are out. They're no longer possible because she chooses white, so all black constellations for her are no longer possible. If she chooses black, all these are no longer possible. But I ask you now, how on earth can she manage to wipe out this and this? She cannot. This is not possible. That's why we think that this theory, taking the arrow framework in order to deal with rights, is unintuitive. And I know that Amartya is still against this, but it's just, you know, something I would like to present to you in order to have you make up your own mind. How can she ever do this? How can a conformist reach that we have conformity in a democratic society without any pressure and, you know, any pressure on the other person to do particular things? How can you arrive at this? I think this is impossible. It is possible that it happens, that we have conformity, but it can also be that we have non-conformity. But you yourself, you have only influence as far as your own future is concerned, and that's it. Okay, Sen said, and this is also something which refers to my third point, procedural aspects. We focus too much on procedures here. We don't focus on outcomes. But we have a paper, I wrote a paper together with Marc Flabet from Princeton, where we really look at outcomes and look back and discuss the issue of, and this is one of the next slides, admissibility and feasibility. Let me see how far we got. This is already a bit too far. Let's take the following example, that there are two persons, I and J, and person I, or let's say we start with person J. Person J has the possibility to invite or not to invite person I to a party. Person I can decide to go or not to go. Now, as you can see, feasible are three out of these four constellations, which means you go when you are invited, you don't go when you are invited, you do not go when you are not invited, but not feasible, except that, you know, there is some violation of, thank you, I don't need it.
Just in case.
Just in case. You see how considerate Flavio really is. What is not possible, except that you exercise some external power is the constellation go and not invite, because then you would intrude the sphere of another person. So what is really important is to look at feasibility and admissibility in their constellations together. And you can, for example, have admissibility and feasibility of an action, which is then guaranteed, for example, if you apply in industrialized countries for social benefits in case of involuntary unemployment. You can do this, you will actually be received by the administration or the local government, and you will get your social benefits, whatever they are. But basically, this is possible. Admissibility and feasibility of an action guaranteed, but no guarantee for a particular outcome. For example, voting in public elections. It's admissible. It's feasible to go to the polling station, but it's not clear what the outcome will be. Admissibility and feasibility of an action guaranteed without the resource constraint of an individual, within the resource constraint, sorry, of an individual, but no guarantee for a particular outcome. So you are in a collaborative framework and you exercise a lot of effort, and others don't do this. They shirk, or they work at very low level of effort, and then you don't reach the outcome which you had hoped would have been reached. Or the scarcity issue, notional and demand against or versus effective demand. You go and try to get a ticket for a concert by a very famous Sir Simon, for example, who's coming to London and leaving, unfortunately, Berlin. Sir Simon Rattle, and you don't get a ticket. So all this is possible. And so I think it is really important not only to look at the, you know, as Professor Sen said, to look at the procedural aspect within all this, but to look at these strategies. Now,
Roger Coisou, whom I was mentioning because of this honorary volume, he already, a long time ago in Social Choice and Welfare, in this journal, he said that, if a consumer deviates from the equilibrium allocation, this is of course admissible, but perhaps it's infeasible due to scarcity. This is not possible. And Potanike and Schunau have looked at this issue in terms of functionings. Given the scarcity of aggregate resources, it's not possible to envision individuals as independently choosing functional bundles for themselves. This can, of course, happen. And I have a very simple example, which is the following, that you have two farmers who are very far away from each other, and there's no friction, there are no externalities, and they decide on whether they want to plant crops or raise cows or pigs or something else. So there will be no friction. So all these alternatives are perfectly possible and all are feasible. But imagine that you have externalities. And my example in the paper, which perhaps some of you have seen, is that we have a beekeeper, for example, and we have a neighbor who has an orchard. And of course then, the functionings of the beekeeper, such as raising bees and, producing honey and so on, are not, harmed at all. But let's assume that the other one, the neighbor, all of a sudden thinks he should chop off all the orchards and start with something like some cleaners or something which has heavy exhaust in terms of chemical substances. Then, of course, the amount of honey which this person is going to produce, and which also means then the economic functionings of this person, will be terribly hindered or at least decreased substantially. So there are these externalities. And I think in that respect, there is really a close relationship between these rights, which are admissible and feasible, or admissible but not feasible. For example, I give you examples. I shouldn't do this anymore in order not to lose time. But I have just marked a couple of situations where you see that, according to Potanike and Shu, these functionings are really interdependent. And this is something which is much closer to your research. The health status of a person may depend on the availability of certain drugs provided by industry or imported by a country. Let's assume a poor country is unable to import a very expensive medication against certain types of cancer. This will, of course, immediately endanger life, of course, will diminish or harm the functionings of several people who suffer under these or from these types of cancer. Or the functionings of a physically handicapped person depend on various investments in the infrastructure of the environment, whether she can mount a bus, whether she can go to the post office, do some very normal things regularly, depends on lots of things. And if the town is unable or claims to be unable to finance all this, then the functionings of this physically handicapped person are really limited. The welfare level of an agrarian country, for example, if the rich nations protect their own territory and don't want anymore as much as they perhaps could from the harvests of these developing countries, that will immediately affect the functionings of these countries. So you see these interrelationships here, and very close, as I said, analogy to rights exercising. Now the next aspect is procedural aspect. As I said, not much really has been done about this. And I chose this because I thought that perhaps, for you, you're so much younger than I am, this is perhaps something you might want to think about and work about. When you teach economics and you teach, let's say, general equilibrium theory, or you teach macro, you never look at the procedures, how certain events, how certain outcomes, economic outcomes come about. And Sen raised this question saying, can consequences be judged adequately without any notion of the process through which they are brought about? Or can one judge procedures adequately in a consequence-independent way? Probably not. So one has to do something about this. Now, Buchanan and Sugden, they are a little out of this criticism because they always emphasize the procedural role of the market mechanism or of government. And when you look at Rawls, for example, he has explicitly touched upon this issue of procedural aspect when he said, you know, as you know, the second principle of justice, social and economic inequalities are to be arranged such they are to the benefit of the worst off, as you know, and now it comes, attached to offices and positions open to all under conditions of fair equality of opportunity. That is a procedural aspect, which is, I think, very important. In social choice theory, we don't have, unfortunately, that much of these procedural aspects, but we have, for example, the equal treatment of voters and the equal treatment of alternatives as procedural requirements. And as I said, the game form approach on rights has this procedural touch, as you can see. But again, I would like to mention and stress again that we also look at outcomes in our approach. Okay. I have a couple of questions here, which I meant to stimulate your thoughts about this lecture and about the whole conference. Should social alternatives, and I have no answers, should social alternatives, which violate certain basic moral or religious principles, be eliminated from an agenda? Should child labor or the production of toys in prisoners' camps be outlawed? Should individuals who are more affected than others by certain measures have a higher weight in a public vote on these measures? Can the claim of being more affected than others be determined in an objective way? There's one example which I've dealt with a couple of years ago, amongst many others, of course, which was the idea of having a market for organs, a market for, not for heart, of course, but for liver and for kidneys. And there's a huge opposition against this. And I was giving this talk, and almost everyone jumped at me, theologians, of course, law people, they said it's ridiculous that you deal with this problem because legislation is such that, full stop. Philosophers were against this, economists not so much. To the good or to the bad of economists, I don't know. That's also something you might want to have your mind, your own idea on. And I remember a particular talk which I gave in a smaller group of the Lions Club, and they were all against the market. And at the end, the chairman said, okay, we see here a clear vote against voting, clear vote against markets for organs, but imagine that your own wife, your own child would badly need an organ. How would you then decide? And I don't know what I would do in my case if my daughter needed an organ and there's a long waiting line. And we know that in Germany, for example, every year about 1,000 people die being in a waiting line for kidney. I don't know what I would do. Fortunately, I'm not in such a situation. And many people then resort to China. And in China, the number of executed prisoners is extremely high, and many people argue that very often the organs then, are on the market. The directors of the prisons earn money by doing this kind of trade, and this is very unfortunate. And this is something which we in our proposal always denied and said we don't want this. We want a clearly regulated market for this, where everything is very clearly specified and the medical treatment is also of first class and so on and so forth, and not something like underground things going on, and then at the end when something goes wrong that nobody wants to be reliable and take care of this and so on. It should be totally different. I just wanted to mention this, this idea that should people who are more affected than others, should they have a stronger vote? It's very difficult. I don't know. So, something about the procedural aspect. Now, your area, capabilities. Now, as far as I read the literature, there is this argument by Nussbaum that there's a long list of functions which people should get or at least have access to certain degrees. And then I looked at several of his papers in the journal of the society and also in some other publications. He is skeptical about fixing a cemented list of capabilities that is complete and fixed for all time. Of course, for all time is always problematic because things change. In order to be very brief here, Sen but also has deep doubts against operationalization of the concept of capability.
And this is exactly what Yongsheng Shu and myself, we have done. And I would like to, just very briefly in the time which is still left, come to this point. The idea is that we take Lancaster's theory of consumer demand. And Lancaster, Kevin Lancaster from Columbia University, who died a couple of years ago, he had the idea that consumer goods create characteristics. These characteristics, proteins or some other things, animal fat and so on and so forth. These characteristics, again, lead to functionings. For example, if this is very bad, food stuff, then your health will be impaired, for example. But I was more thinking about investments, for example, in human capital, investments in schooling and so forth, that people learn to write and to calculate and so on and so forth. And by having these functionings, have the opportunity to get a better job than if they hadn't had this kind of education. So we start from investment in consumer goods or investment goods like investment in education and schools and so on, go to characteristics, and again from characteristics we go to functionings. This is all naive, I assume, all the more because we but this is just the simplest way to deal with it in a linear way. You could do it in a non-linear way, which then becomes much more complicated. So let's look at situations where we have capability sets. So, can one operationalize the concept of capability? Sen is doubtful. Now you can, with all these doubts, you can look at what I'm going to present now. Consider a two-dimensional space of functionings, which are like this. This is very trivial, because B has is also in A. So A is better than B, very trivial, no problem. Okay. What can be said in a case where the intersection is non-empty, but B is a subset, but B not being a subset of A? And then if there were a preference ranking, we would have perhaps a situation like this one, which I think also is easy, and I beg your pardon, to some degree, I have my qualms. Because, what we do in microeconomics and undergraduate lectures is we have indifference curves. We have utility functions. Very often they are nicely shaped, and then we look at the best point. That's so easy, it's wonderful. But, we assume very regular utility functions here. And the other thing is, what kind of preference is it, actually? Is it a short-term preference? Is it a long-term preference? Is it a paternalistic preference? What is it, actually? Of course, if all this is clarified for a particular person, a particular country, or whatever, then maybe you may resort to these indifference curves and say, A is better than B because, the best point in A is clearly better than the best point in B. Okay. We find this,
I don't know, I've been teaching so much economics and always, you know, utility functions and address boxes, and this is a very nice tool, but at some point you start thinking about what you are actually doing. And I've also been teaching cognitive science students, and they're very much against economics. They are very much against rationality assumptions and all kinds of things. And they doubt utility function. What is this a utility function? What do you mean? And such a regular utility function with first and second derivative, everything smooth, and what are you really talking about? So what we actually propose here is something which takes up monotonicity, which means we prefer more to less, but not really a preference relationship. And the question then is, how far away from, or how much are we on the way to actually assuming preference relations in our approach? So again, let's look at what I said before. For example, as I said, an investment in schooling and medical equipment promotes a higher level of literacy and a better state of health of the general public, so that the level of functionings will be increasing. This actually is, you know, as you may know, just as a footnote, in Germany we had 850,000 immigrants in 2015, and 300,000 more which were unregistered. We now have a huge problem in this country, and this problem really is that very often they don't speak our language, of course not, but their education was very rudimentary. So what we really have to do in Germany now is to get all kinds of resources in order to train them, in order to invest into their schooling so that they can learn the language, understand certain things about the German society, and so on and so forth. And this, of course, eventually, hopefully, will increase their functionings so that they can be employed. At the moment, very, very few people are actually employed. Maybe it's too short term at the moment, after just 1.5 years or something like this. But still, industry says, you know, very often it's not possible really to employ them. Their degree, their level is too low in order to have them do certain jobs. So this is really, I think, important. Okay, so in our simplified way, let's see, yeah. It's this one. We now, as I said, we start from investment in education or whatever, you know, consumer goods. According to Lancaster, create characteristics, and from these, then we get to a space of functionings. Of course, as I said, it's very simple. It's very simple and simplified. So what we now assume is monotonicity in northeast direction, which means if we have valuable functionings, and we are talking here about valuable functionings and not destructive things, valuable functionings, we would like to go as far as possible into the northeast direction. Now there is a reference point, and from this reference point, we would say, not knowing really what, you know, the actual development will be like, we take the quarter ball in northeast direction, and now if we compare two sets A and B, we would argue that A is better than B because the possibilities amongst A are better than the possibilities, obviously, amongst B for this kind of situation. This is the first picture. There's another one where the reference point is outside. So this is a situation of deprivation where we would do the same in the southwest direction and then compare A and B. So again, this is very simple, and as Sen said, you know, he's very skeptical about this operationalization. But at the end of the day, perhaps we would like to compare the situation of different countries, be it wealthy countries or be it countries who are still in their early stage of development, and say something about how they fare, how they have prospered over time, and so on. Of course, you could do it in the way Nussbaum was proposing it, but also there you have a problem, because you can't expect vector dominance. So that if you have, let's say, as she said, a long list of functionings, and you now take two countries, for example, want to compare how they fare against each other, you will never have the case that in these vectors of functionings, one is always better in every respect than the other. You will never have this.
only if you have, let's say, a comparison between a very poor country and, let's say, Norway or Luxembourg, which are highest according to, you know, income per capita and other indicators. Then, of course, you will have this. But if you are interested in how different countries in Africa or in Asia fare, you will probably, with high probability, not get vector dominance. So also there, you will have this problem of weighing things or trade-offs among different components in these vectors, right? So there's also this possibility, this problem, if you think that basically the Nussbaum approach of looking at particular functionings is worth doing. And this is, of course, much more abstract. Okay, now we think that perhaps, you know, this line along which the reference vector develops is something which is more than just a single line starting from the origin, but it could be some cone. And if you have a cone, then you have something like an efficiency frontier from which you would do exactly the same. You know, looking at the the comparability between A and B, and then saying that in this case, for example, this is also one of these simple cases. You know, in one of our papers, which Shu and I wrote, we have more complicated situations, that again, A would be better than B. Now, what I did in a paper which was published in Social Choice in 2012, and I did it alone. I don't know, Shu thought perhaps this is too much, he should just change a little bit his scientific work. So I did it alone, that perhaps it's not the full quarter goal, but it is something like, you know, some small angle which is of interest. And also it could be that if you, you know, go for several decades or at least several years, it could be that, you know, one or two of the functionings, because here it's just two dimensional, otherwise I would not be able to really have a nice picture like this one. But some of the functionings have reached a satiation level, so that if you start with, let's say, a space of n functionings, some of the functionings have reached satiation. So, for example, you would, in certain parts of the world, you would, for example, no longer care about clean water because it's available everywhere. So you would no longer look at this issue, but you would look at other issues, like, for example, an adequate treatment of, let's say, very complicated illnesses, and so on. So it could be that, you know, this dimensionality shrinks, and also that you would like to have a particular direction which is less than the quarter ball. Or it could even be that at the end of the day you find out that some of the functionings have reached a level which is too high in order to make sense for this particular society. So then you would have something like anti-monotonicity, you would go into a different direction. All this is very abstract, and I never really you know, did any empirical work on this, but my hope is that perhaps some of you will pick this up and do some interesting work. So my conclusions are that you know, I wanted not to talk about things where we all agree to, but I wanted to select things where perhaps we, you know, disagree, or whether we think that it is still totally unsatisfactory. So pros and cons, interconnection between rights and freedom, the importance of procedures, I would say, not much has been done there, and then your own territory, capabilities, their comparison among individuals and nations. All this, I think, is worth doing, and I think these are very important issues for economics in general. So I think these topics require further work, and I want to thank you very much.